The police order the crowds to disperse, but no one does, and even more come. They too bring flowers, but can't get through. There is no second warning as tear gas canisters and grenades cut through the crowds. There's confusion. A few pick them up and throw them back. The Zelmo riot squads charge. They run. He runs with them. Someone sees his camera and shouts, "Shoot this fucking hell, man." He does. Crowds get pushed back and return.
I was a moving man in my younger days, but I'm gone now. I'm out rambling away. I left that road so far behind, and now I know. Oh, man,
he finds a spot behind a hedgerow and points his camera at a group of Zelmo. 10 or so, with shields and gas masks, tear gas launchers and pistols in holsters. Battle ready. Through the viewfinder, he sees one staring back. He watches his right arm slide down to the holster, and it's enough. He drops behind a hedge, camera on chest, heart and throat. He hears a shot and watches a bullet pierce an awning over the entrance of an apartment building, just a few feet above his head. He runs across the street to a spot behind a weeping willow and waits. He hears men talking. "I think they're shooting rubber bullets," one says. "No way, they're using blanks." But there's a quick correction. Bursts of automatic weapons fire sever the limbs of the weeping willow. End of conversation. Run. Others are still incredulous. "They can't be shooting at us," they say, even as flashes appear where the bullets strike pavement and plaster separates from the walls. Blue vans circle the crowds. People run back and forth through the narrow bridges over the tiny river Jimita. A sliding door opens. The muzzle of a KBK AK assault rifle begins to flash, and a split second later, the sound. And then another. This one like bone against metal. A man falls on the bridge. He catches with the corner of his eye. People gathering over a body. He turns and sees blood pooling under the man's head and dripping in the river. He lifts the camera to his eye and shoots the fucking hell. He will later tell himself that he acted like a reporter and not a human. He will be wrong. He checks the counter. Two left. He watches as four men grab the victim by his arms and legs and begin to run. He runs with them, along the river. The blue van circles back. The sliding door is open and men are on their knees, taking aim. More flashes. Bursts. He slides down the embankment for cover. The others follow suit. It was like a safari, he'll remember. The van drives away. Again, they pick up the body. He runs in parallel, camera up, focused, ready. He waits for the right step, the flat ground, the cushion, the point where the eye, the hands, the equipment are all level, and no breath remains in the lungs, all reflex. He shoots. 3 days later, he'll bring the negatives into the darkroom. He'll mix the chemicals and pour them into the trays. He will slide the negatives into the enlarger, project the image onto the paper, and drop the paper into the first tray. He will repeat this process with every shot, until he gets to this one. When he gets to it, he will pause. He will realize that a man had been murdered in front of him, and it won't be an anonymous soldier or an accident victim on the 7 o'clock news. It will be a man who just a few minutes earlier might have been running alongside him. He will later learn his name, Michal Adamovich, 28, father of two, hit in the back of the head by a bullet from a KBK AK assault rifle, fired from a blue van with a sliding door. He won't recall taking the picture, and he won't learn the names of the other men until much later, like Jerzy Stanzewski, who ran ahead of the group and flagged down a car to take Michał to the hospital, or Mateusz Borkowski, who had just picked up his wife from work and was still carrying her purse. He will hide the negatives outside of some obscure village on the perimeters of Lubin. In 2 years, he will smuggle them out to West Berlin, hidden in the leather of his briefcase. That's where he'll hand them to the editor of a local publication and never see them again. When he returns, they will say, "We don't have any negatives." They will ask him for a receipt. He will say, "I never thought I'd need one." The prince will survive, and one set will make it out. The photo of the man carrying Michał Adamowicz will be published all over the world. The author, unknown. Three men were killed that day, and many others wounded. 7 years later, the communists fell to solidarity in one of the most peaceful revolutions the world had seen. In 2007, on the 25th anniversary of the event in Lubin, the nation paid tribute. I flew in from Chicago and stood in awe of the men who shot at my father, his image the size of a five-story building. But for me, it was my father, who was five stories tall that day. I watched as a young couple walked under the weeping willow tree toward one of his photographs. They stood there for some time, holding hands, looking into the faces of the men who marched and died for their freedom. And Bob Geldof sang "Crazy" on a stage by a bridge over the river Zimnica.